Thank you very much for being here this evening. Welcome to the 34th public lecture of the Irish Environmental History Network. The network was founded in 2009 in Trinity College, really with the aim of promoting work in Ireland that aims to understand how humans have influenced the environment and been influenced in return by the environment. So obviously how humans have perceived the natural world and the environment is really key as a question here, and how they have also been educated to perceive the environment really informs how it's managed. So we're delighted, really delighted, as a 34th speaker here to have Dr. Patricia Oliver to come and talk to us about environmental education in Ireland. I won't say much more. I'm going to hand over to Professor Ronnie Russell, who will chair the event this evening, and he can say some more. Thank you.
Thank you very much, and a very warm welcome to everyone this evening. For those who've managed to get through the traffic, it's quite something out there this evening. Anyway, it's great to see such a good turnout, and as Frank has said, this is the 34th meeting or lecture of the Irish Environmental History Network, and it's something that I must admit I didn't realise existed until fairly recently, but they've been doing a great job, and they have their web page up on the college website under the history department, and anybody who is interested in attending any of their functions, they are all very welcome, and you can just keep your eye on them on the website publicise it, anyone who's interested in the whole general area. Okay, well that brings me to this evening's lecture, and it gives me great pleasure to introduce Dr. Pat Oliver, double doctor, Maynooth and Trinity College, to give her overview of how, I suppose, things happened to her in life leading towards the Green Campus Programme, the Green Flag Programme, the Blue Flag Programme, and many other of the European environmental programmes. And she has experienced a great number of different programmes, environmental programmes and other, and she'll hopefully give us an insight into the nice bits of it, and probably the not so nice bits of it as well, the struggles. So without any further ado, I'll hand over to Patricia.
Thank you very much indeed, Ronnie. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Good. I'm switched on, I think. And Francis, thank you so much for the invitation. I have a little clicker here. Always wanted to have one of these. Now, let me see, can I make it work? Ah, I can. Okay. Right, that's me. And this is not me. But I'm not going to tell you actually about her. I put her up when I was doing this earlier, and now I've decided that maybe the thing I was going to say about her is a little bit long, so I may come back to her at the end if you stay with me that long. One of my favourite authors is John le Carré, and in his memoir, The Pigeon Tunnel, he says, "Being dispassionate, sticking to the bold facts with no self-serving declaration or omissions, pure memory remains as elusive as a bar of wet soap." So tonight I am chasing this bar of wet soap and clutching it frantically, trying to tell you a story. And essentially that's what it is. It's a story of what happened when a whole lot of other things happened, and we find out as we go along. I want to start by talking about UNTASCA, the National Trust for Ireland. And if I may, I will just quote from a book which was written by someone who's here this evening, and this is it. It's called The First 50 Years, and it's about Lancashire. And Valerie Bond is the author, and she did a fantastic job of recording the history of Lancashire. And what she said was, or she quotes in it, as World War II had drawn to a close in the 40s, many people who were concerned about the environment realized that peace would be followed by very large development of both cities and the countryside. They felt that the country needed an organization such as the National Trust in the UK, which would monitor such developments. And I think that we could all, I think it was very prescient actually, because that's exactly what happened. Maybe not immediately after the Second World War, but certainly later. You can think of the 60s and some of the destruction. I think it was, this thing is moving on its own. Right, so Lancashire was founded in 1948. Well, the first meeting was in 1946, but it was registered in 1948. And the first president was a man called Robert Lloyd Praeger, who was a most extraordinary man. And this is what he said on radio, where on a broadcast in 1948. I take it that we are at the beginning, this is Lancashire, of a long and also delicate piece of work calling for patience, tact, judgment and industry, as well as enthusiasm, but our goal is a noble one, and once it is fully appreciated, there is little reason that anyone's hand should be turned against us. I'm not so sure that that has been always the case, but at the same time, I think that that does say what they really were thinking about when they set up Lancashire. And I'm going to do a little plug here, if you don't mind, because I will be moving away from Lancashire and into the education unit. But I do want to say that for those who are not members of Lancashire, think about it. It needs new members, especially young new members. So really do think about it. Its work is absolutely critical in my view. So, yes, well, I'm sort of pushing ahead here. I became involved in Lancashire when I was asked by a former director of Lancashire called Lockie Kennedy to come and put together a newspaper for the organisation. Now, I was in the publishing business. I was a European editor for Macmillan's, but I had never published a newspaper, but Lockie was one of these people who said things like, oh, there's no problem, you can do it easy, I'll show you how to do it. And then he sat down and showed you how to fix photographs and so on, and actually, he made me do it. So I ended up being the editor of the magazine of the organisation. First of all, it's newspaper, then it's magazine, and of course, then you are drawn, if you ever are involved in a publication of an organisation, you are drawn into it. So you begin to kind of, you know everybody after a while. And I used to visit local associations and get all their news and so on, and suddenly I found myself right in the centre, and before I knew where I was, I had become the honorary secretary, then the deputy chair, and then the chair. So I suddenly found myself the chair of Lancashire, indeed not the first woman who's here tonight, Consuelo O'Connor, the first chairwoman of Lancashire, but I became a chair of Lancashire, and I found that being the chair of a voluntary organisation, of course, the big thing, it doesn't matter if it's a voluntary organisation or what it is, you never think about anything except money. You're always looking for money. And you think that that's not going to be your role, but it turns out to be your role. So when I was in the chair of Lancashire, I was so lucky because this man was elected president. And he was Professor Frank Mitchell, Professor of Quaternary Studies in Trinity, And it is one of the great links with this university that I have had, because this man, he was the most extraordinary man, wonderful, wonderful man. And he had this quiet, analytical approach to things, and he had gave the total support to my wildest ideas. And he would look just quietly at this madwoman who had, who was proposing to do all kinds of things, and he would quietly, you know, sit. And so I decided that what we needed was a legacy program, because the National Trust in the UK, especially in Scotland, where we had pretty good ties, they have huge money that comes from legacies. I mean, it's enormous, you wouldn't believe it, how much money they get from legacy. So I thought we need a legacy program. But you have to have money to do a legacy program, you see. You have to have money to start. So I thought, okay, I kept telling everybody that this is what we needed. And I came in one day, and here was Frank, and he pushed a check into my pocket and said, I was going to leave it in my will, but you need it now. So, that gave me a start. Now, the only thing was that I needed a development officer who was going to run the legacy program, and that's a full-time job, and I wanted somebody in the office who thought about nothing else, forget about the environment. I don't care if they're knocking down Christchurch. I want to think about legacies, and who do we know, and are they a member? Are they rich? I mean, it's appalling how you can become. Anyway, I decided that we had an environment officer at the time, the only member of staff who was not administrative, and he was David Hickey. I wish he was here tonight, wonderful guy. And he was funded by the World Wide Fund for Nature because they were really forward-looking. And they had an awful lot of money at the time, but they didn't want to muscle in on another country. They wanted to help other organizations who didn't have money. And they didn't come and say, we're setting up our own organization here. They looked at the organizations that were there and thought, can we help them? So they helped us by giving us David. So I thought to myself, I wonder would they give me a development officer? So I flew over to London and I said to them, would you give me the money for a development officer? And they said, no. We never give the money for a development officer unless the organization does a business plan. So I said, would you give me the money to do a business plan? And they kind of laughed, because they had never given anybody the money to do a business plan, but they thought, well, okay then. So I came back with the money for a business plan. Now, the thing then is, have you ever done a business plan? Well, hands up those who've done a business plan. You know the pain. You know the pain. We had a consultant, and she says, a business plan only works if you bring everybody in your organization with you. So you must bring everybody with you. Now look at it. 4,000 members, a president and officers, a 50-person council, 30 local associations, a National Environment Committee, Organization Committee, and 6 subcommittees. And you had to bring them all with you. And this is where Valerie Bond, again Valerie, I have to say, she was the administrator of Nantashka, super efficient, and she said, okay, I'll help you. And we began, and I tell you, it was painful. It was so painful. But we did it. And what happened then? Oh yes, I have to go back. I'm still in the pain. We decided that we needed to know one of the things that they said we had to find out was, what did our members want? What did they think of us? What did they want? Now, we didn't want to know what they thought of us. We just wanted to know what they wanted. So we did a survey and we asked them. And we asked all our members and all our committees. And, you know, as you can imagine, a lot of things came back. But the extraordinary thing that came back was that our members more than anything else wanted to be involved in education. Now, the interesting thing about that is that we had always been involved in education, but the sort of thing, you know, like a competition. Indeed, Consuelo O'Connor was our chairwoman of our education committee, and she ran a lot of education programs where we had prizes and people did all sorts of things. Schools did, you know. But this was different. They wanted us to be involved in education in a much more formal way. And we understood what they wanted. They wanted environmental education. Suddenly they were seeing this is what, we could see that this is what the members wanted. So we set up the Education Committee in 1993. And you can see that some of the names that are there are still on the committee today. And in fact, Margaret Sweeney, who's here tonight, was on the committee, and she only retired from it last year, having been a marvelous member of the committee. So this committee is, what can I say about this committee? I am here tonight being honoured. But actually, I mean, these are the people who should be honoured as well. Because they are the ones who have been stalwart in support all through the years. Support in the way that you want it, you know, where it's not negative, it's not criticizing, it's yes, let's try that. Okay, that's a good idea. What can we do to help? This is critical for if you have a committee. So you can see now that we've got as far as education. Now you see, you were wondering had you come into the wrong place, because here's this woman, I know she's talking about money and legacies, but now we are at education. Environmental education in my day, and people, you know, younger people say things to you like, did they have radios in your day? But in my day, environment wasn't a word that was used at all. When I'm thinking of myself at school, nature, you know, there would be a nature table. And they would talk about, you know, leaves and this and that and the other and planting trees. But as I lived in the inner city, there was never any possibility of planting a tree. So we kind of had a picture of an oak. So, you know, I was pretty well educated in the natural environment. They wanted us to be involved in education. So, I'm really ahead of myself, I think. What happened then is the way things happen. We set up the education unit, and there I am in the office, sitting one day in Taylor's Hall, worrying about money as usual, and thinking, you know, we have to do something about this education thing. When I get a call from Brendan O'Donoghue, who is the Secretary General of the Department of the Environment, and he says, Pat, will you take on to join FEE as the Irish representative, the Foundation for Environmental Education, and will you take on to run the Blue Flag for Beaches campaign? Now, the Blue Flag for Beaches campaign had been introduced into Ireland by Karen Dubsky of Coastwatch some years previously. And my answer to that was, go away from me. I am not taking on to run any other program. I'm too busy looking to pay the rent. Well, we didn't actually have any rent because we had the Taylor's Hall, which has belonged to Dublin City Council, and they gave it to us for a shilling a year for 100 years. But that's beside the point. I still had to pay the phone bill. So anyway, I said, Brendan, you know, I can't. I said, oh, no, we'll support it. This is a really important program, he said. This is actually a program that he understood, and he was very prescient in this, that the Blue Flag, with full support from local authorities, would actually be a great way of making the Bathing Water Directive, or the first Bathing Water Directive. And so, when he said he'd pay for it, I said, come and have a cup of coffee. So he did. And then he said to me, how much do you want to run it? Now, can you imagine? Do you remember that, Margaret? I rang Margaret Sweeney, I said, what did I ask him for? And she said, okay, let's sit down and see how much you can do it for. Let's see. So we worked out how to do it for that, and then we said, let's ask him for that. And then when I asked him for that, and he said yes, I said, oh, I should have asked him for that. But of course, anyway, he said yes, and we took on to do the Blue Flag for Beaches campaign. And that was... how many years ago? My goodness, Ronnie. 1993. Don't let's go back that far. Anyway, it's 25 years ago, I think. This is today. These are the Blue Flag and the Green Coast, I'll tell you about in a minute. This is the coast of Ireland, and in my view, this is like a necklace of blue flags all around the country, and I just love it. Because when we started, we only had dots here and there. And I have to say that the local authorities did step up to the plate, and they did see the value. And they rolled in behind it. And while nothing is perfect, I accept that, and many people who go to a blue flag beach will ring us up in high dudgeon, because it's not the way they wanted it to be. But in general, it is an international eco label, probably one of the best known ones. And it has made a huge difference. I mean, okay, bathing water quality is the big one, but it's to do with beach management, it's to do with safety, it's to do with all those aspects that you want when you go to a beach. So Blue Flag was the first program that the education unit did, and then we took on to do Green Coast grew out of it because we were doing Blue Flag and we had the relationships with local authorities, and we took on to do an Interreg program with Keep Wales Tidy, and we ended up coming up with Green Coast, and that is the program. And here today are the Green Coast groups. There are two elements. There's an award which the local authority gets for having a beach that has all the things you need for a Green Coast, and then there are Green Coast groups which are all around the country, and today we have more than 500 of them all around the coast, and they are people who live on the coast and who value the coast and who love the coast and who want to mind it. Now, they may want to mind it for themselves, but I don't mind that, because we're going there too. Although, mind you, a lot of them keep saying, we don't want any more because it'll only bring people. So, as you can imagine, they try to hide it sometimes. And we find that we've raised the flag, and then the next week they take it down. But it has been a huge success. I mean, the sort of things that the groups do is just fantastic. So, this is some of them. The intermingling with all the kind of groups, you've got people who are scuba divers, and every sort of group that is on the coast has become, most of them have become Clean Coast groups. And they all have different, you have people who are divers, and you have people who are, even have businesses, and they have become Clean Coast groups, and they do keep their places clean. I mean, there are cleanups that go on like this the whole year round. Now, the thing here is that I didn't know anything at all about the Bathing Water Directive, let's be honest here. I hadn't a clue. I'm not a scientist. I had heard of the Blue Flag, but I didn't know anything about it, and now I was running it. So my job was to build partnerships with people who did actually know what they were doing. And what I wanted to say here is that I knew how to find out who did know. And for any younger people who are here, when you find that you don't know anything, The best thing to do is to be quite honest and say, I don't know anything about this, can you help me? And invariably, people who do know will help you. And this is one of them here in front of me, beside me. Ronnie was one of the people who came with all that you needed, the expertise, the knowledge. In fact, he has an encyclopedic knowledge of the coast anyway, particularly Donegal. He was on my Blue Flag journey, very first Blue Flag journey. He'd already been involved with Karen, isn't that right, in setting it up. But he came on board straight away, and Back Masterson from UCD, another expert. And then we had people from Irish Water Safety, and we had people from the Department of the Environment, and so on. And they all knew what they were doing, but I was the chair. And you know, if you don't know anything, you should always be the chair. Honestly, at one stage, when I was in the chair of UNTASHBA, the department of the people that give me, I can't remember the name of them, who hire people for the civil service, what do they call it? Commission, the commission. They used to ask me to sit on interview panels. And I remember once sitting on an interview panel for engineers. County engineers. Now, can you imagine? I hadn't got a clue about anything to do with engineering, but I said, I'll do it if I'm the chair. Because then I could be nice. And I could say things like, do tell me all about yourself. And I didn't have to know if the answer was right. In fact, more than the time I was chairing for engineers, county engineers, and when this guy went out, I said, I was just about to say, gosh, he sounds really impressive. When the engineers on either side to me looked at each other and said, I would never cross a bridge he'd build. So you see, you don't need any expertise to be the chair. You just need to be surrounded by people who do. So that was me, a harmonious relationship. And this is actually comes from a book by David Rowe, whom I was hoping would be here this evening. Who was a former president. Is he here?
Yes.
Oh, David, I didn't see. Oh, I'm so pleased you're here. Did you recognize it from your book? Yeah. David wrote a book about planning. And you were the chair of the planning committee for years. Actually, when you look at Dublin, you would shake your head, wouldn't you? He was the chair of the planning committee. But he wrote this wonderful book, and you can see that he's a talented artist as well. And I love this, because that's exactly how people go on. And it doesn't do any good at all, I can tell you. Anyway. I think I'm rambling here. I'm showing you now very quickly some sponsors that we've had, and I'm going to not spend time on them because I'll come back to them. What happened next? FEE, the Foundation for Environmental Education. We had become the Irish member of FEE. And I'm just going to tell you quickly about these people, because I think that they were wonderful. And I think that I want to, you know, respect their name. So, Harry Valls from Holland, Jean-Baptiste de Villemorin from France, José de Sánchez Moro from Spain, I think it's actually José de Sánchez Moro from Spain, Graham Ashworth from the UK, Lola Lovick Simonson from Denmark. They were all teachers, and they all knew one another through the Council of Europe. And they were very, very forward-thinking, and they had met through the Council of Europe, come together and talked about things that they were passionate about. And they came together and they had a big seminar, people got together, and they founded the Foundation for Environmental Education in Europe. There was another E, there it is there, Foundation for Environmental Education in Europe. The last E is now gone, because it's global now. So, I just love these people. I met them when I became the Irish representative, and it was so fantastic to meet them. I mean, you can just imagine now, when I became, and Brendan O'Donoghue said to me, will you take on to do the Blue Flag? And I protested, and then I said yes. And then he said, can you be in Denmark on Thursday? So I thought, well, think about it. It'd be kind of nice. And when I say that that was the beginning of Denmark and Finland and Spain, and it was very nice. I'm not the member for it anymore. It's just as well. The airports are not nearly as good as they were then. Anyway, I love these people. They were wonderful people. They were passionate. And they set up this foundation, which has now grown. And this was the vision. The vision of the Foundation for Environmental Education, a sustainable world in which education creates positive change for all. You know, it's easily tripped off the tongue. But what they wanted was action. They didn't just want to say things, they wanted to take action on things. So everything that they were thinking about this was practical. It was a match made in heaven as far as I was concerned. From our point of view, it gave us access that we had never had before. It was extraordinarily good for us. This is Fee now at a glance, all over the place. I think I have a little thing that makes a sort of a, doesn't it make a little? Oh no, I can't remember what it's supposed to do. Never mind. Well, you can see us up there. And Northern Ireland, of course, is in it. And the Alliance is what we set up then. When I became a part of it, and then the UK were in it, and then Wales wanted to be in, Scotland wanted to be in, Northern Ireland wanted to be all members independently. Which Spain was actually rather worried about because they didn't want having the Basques were trying to get in as a separate thing. We won't talk about that. We set up the Alliance, and you know, it was amazing. Meeting these people from people entirely from Scotland, from Northern Ireland, from Wales, at Fee meetings internationally, we would end up sitting on the bus for 3 hours together. And you would be sitting beside, I was sitting beside this guy, Nigel, who told me about this program that he was running in the UK. And he said, oh, I think they'd be interested in doing it in Ireland. We're talking to our sponsors next week. Why don't you fly over to London and meet them? And I come back with a program, with materials, with sponsors, for nothing. That's the kind of relationships that this gave us entrance to. So Fee, for us, was wonderful. And the Alliance, to me, was just worth a fortune. Now, we are still the Environmental Education Unit, but this is today, and there are 9 programs here, but actually, the staff haven't upgraded the slide. I'm looking around at a couple of them. And there's 3 missing, because I couldn't get a slide that had the whole 12 on. There are 3 that are not here. But this gives you an idea. We started with Blue Flag, then we had Clean Coasts, then we have National Spring Clean, I think, came next, and then we have the rest. I'll be coming to these ones over here shortly. I'm going to try and quickly, gosh, I'm running out of time, I'm running through this very fast. This is a little program, National Spring Clean. 500,000 people every year, more than, cleaning up litter. But I can't let you read it because I'm moving on. 1,750 tons of litter collected and 5,000 cleanups and 35% of the material is recycled. Neat Streets, that's a school program for secondary schools, and it's all to do with litter and the recycling levels. There was an 89% increase when the school started Neat Streets. Reduction in littering in the school, reduction in littering in the wider community, and 90% of the schools went on to achieve their flag. They sort of fast-tracked the flag. It normally takes 2 years, and they managed it more quickly. IBAL Litter League and the wonderful Dr. Tom Kavanagh stands head and shoulders over everyone in his efforts to clean up Ireland. And IBAL, Irish Business Against Litter, they hire us to do the monitoring. And in 2006 we started, and there was a cleanliness rating of 90 or higher for 5% of the towns that we surveyed. And today, 35% of the towns are at 90 cleanliness rating. And the thing is that people still say, oh, it's so filthy and so on, but actually you wouldn't realise how much cleaner the country has become, because it has happened over a gradual period of 10 years. And of course the inner cities, parts of the inner cities, are still in a pretty bad way. But these are all litter campaigns. This is Young Reporters for the Environment, and this is a feed programme, and this relates to secondary schools, and it's for those students who are interested in being a reporter or a journalist. I'm not too sure what those two were up to, but anyway. Now, this is another one, Green Communities, and I could tell you a whole raft of things, and Rob gave me 14 photographs, but I couldn't put them all up. There's a nice one. This is a new programme with the education unit, and it's the Green Flag for Parks. And boy, are the parks thrilled. The thing is, you probably don't know this, and I didn't. Parks are the poor relations of the local authority. And whenever they have a bad year, and they need to cut down on expenditure, they cut the budget of the park. But now, the parks have a flag that they can get, but they need resources. And it will bring credit on the local authority if they have the flag. And people will be pleased with them. And they can have the minister down to raise the flag. And they can have the local councillors. And everybody will be very happy. So we need more resources, manager. And they're getting them. And this was 2016. How many, Rob? How many parks are in it now?
36
parks. This is only in how many years?
2 years.
2 years. We've got 375% increase, or something like that. They love it, because actually it's a very good programme. This is another one that we got from the Alliance. This comes from the UK, and they've been doing it for a number of years. But it's a terrific programme, because there's the formal parks themselves that apply, and they do all sorts of management things, and then there's a community aspect to it. And that brings in the people. Well, the people come in anyway, but now you're bringing them in to help you instead of coming in to annoy you and destroy everything. So this is a nice photograph. Look at those flowers. Actually, I think we were giving out, though. We should have brought them tonight. We were giving out packs of wildflowers, and I saw some in the office. Why didn't you keep bringing them in? Okay. Now, this is the last one. Learning about forestry. Brilliant program, came from Scandinavia. It's a fee program, came from Scandinavia, been running it there for 20 years, and it's all about learning about forests, school children learning about forests. And I wanted to run it long before I retired, but I couldn't because I had no money. And then the current director flouted himself, because now he's got this great sponsor. This lovely woman in Limerick has taken on to sponsor LEAF, and she is passionate about it. And the schools in Limerick, especially the inner city in Limerick, are coming to the forest down there in Curraghchase, and they are having a whale of a time. Really, aren't they? I mean, biodiversity, tree planting, you name it. The one thing we are not doing is having camps and campfires. Anyway, I'm hurrying along quickly, because we have now got to Rio in 1992, and we have Agenda 21 and the call from Rio for a transformation of attitudes and behaviour. And the FEE response. FEE wanted to respond to the call from Rio, and they came up with eco schools. They were all teachers, so they were looking for something that was involved with education, and they got some money from the EU, and they started creating the programme. They tested it in 5 countries, and then they rolled it out to the whole FEE network, and it's engaging the youth of today to protect the climate of tomorrow. And it works. This is the flag. Now, this is serendipity, and this has been the word that really encapsulates everything that has happened, as far as I'm concerned. And it's a pleasant surprise or a fortunate happenstance. Did you know that Horace Walpole was the one who thought up that word? I didn't know. Anyway, eco schools. In Ireland, we are green schools. And this is my lovely, I love this. Look at that graph. Look at it. We started down there, and year by year by year, it grew so fast that in year five, I think it was, we were at 1,000, was it? I can't see it from here. Anyway, we got a fright. We couldn't keep up with it. We were running out of money. And the reason was because I had come back from London with having seen the pilot. They had a video in London, and they showed the video in London at a Blue Flag meeting and said, this is a new program, and we're offering it now because we've tested it and it works. And they showed this video of a junior school and a senior school, and it blew me away. Absolutely fantastic. So back I came and I said, what are we going to do? Had a Blue Flag meeting ourselves here, and I said to the local authorities, I've just come back, and I told them about it, and they all sort of said, and then they went. But Jerry O'Sullivan from Kerry County Council came up and said to me, Pat, you've got to do this, he says. I said, Jerry, go away from me, I'm not money. I'll give you £1,000, he said. And I gave his pounds then, I think. That's that long ago. And I said, Jerry, 1,000, wonderful. But I mean, I will need staff. I'll give you 2,000, he said. It'll give you comfort. It'll give you inspiration. It'll make you, you know. So anyway, he said, I'll send you the check tomorrow. And off he went home. When I was driving home, I thought, Jerry sort of did give me €1,000. What would any other local authority give me? So I rang John Quinlivan, the manager of Loud County Council, next morning, and I had been on the board of the National Roads Authority with him, and I said, hi John, Pat Oliver here, and he said, how much? And I said, stop that, John, now don't be like that. And he said, now listen here, I have this fabulous programme. Would you give me €1,000 a year for 3 years, pounds, if I tell you that this programme, you've never heard of it, it's never been in Ireland, but I tell you it's brilliant. And he said, okay. I thought, right. So then I rang the manager of Wexford County Council, because he was a good pal of ours, and we'd had the Blue Flag Awards down there, and I got one from him. And then I was on to something, not a goal maybe, and by the end of the day, I had €5,000. So then I rang David Jeffrey, Professor David Jeffrey from Trinity, and I said, David, do you have a student who's just graduating, who is a fire plant, who is jumping out of their skin looking for a job? He said, I'm the very woman for you. And there she is up there. And it's Elizabeth Arnett, who you may remember as the voice of Irish Water when they were in real trouble. And she had the worst job in Ireland, but by God, she could do it. I said, Elizabeth, I've got €5,000, and if you can get the rest of them in, you have a job. And she said, right. So then every morning she'd say, I've got another one, I've got another one. And by the end of the year, we'd every local authority in the country as part of the programme. And this is what happened. Because then we started getting in touch with the schools, and then the schools came on board, and then the schools loved it. The thing was that I had the money from the local authorities, but that was actually the key to the whole success. Because the local authorities were the ones who suddenly realised that this gave them a relationship with schools which they'd never had. They'd always been supplying them with services, but they didn't have a relationship. But suddenly, they began to see the effect that the programme was having. You know, diversion of waste from landfill. Within 2 years, we were showing diversion of waste on average 40% from the schools that were in the programme. So the thing began to go like this, and then of course, I'm going to wrap it up very quickly. The point is that we ran out of money. We started worrying about what are we going to do if the teachers get bored? What are we going to do if we haven't got enough resources? They're still joining and we can't stop them because they're talking to other teachers. And that meant that we had to go out and look for more money. And luckily enough, we did. And this is Green Schools today. 97% of schools in Ireland are there. over 150 teacher training events every year, 900 schools submitting environmental data annually. That's because we only have, you know, a third of the schools do the data collection anyway. 20 Green Flag Award ceremonies every year. You can imagine how much the local authorities love that. I remember when, who was it I'm thinking of? Who was the minister? Dick Roach. He was at every flag raising in the country. I saw six photographs of him in the Meath Chronicle running short at so many different schools raising the flag. And of course the schools love the day of that, especially the first flag, because it's a huge success, because they have to work hard. This is not easy. This is not easy. You start with waste, you set yourself a target. Then you go on to 2 years, you get your first flag. Then you go on to do a vision. When we hand them the flag, we say, but now you have to go back and start working on energy. And then 2 years later, we hand them another flag and we say, now you have to go back and work on water. And anyway, where are we now? These are the stats. I don't know if you can read them, but if you can, I can't read them from here. 6.3 million units of electricity. Can anyone read that for me? I can't see it. These are the stats that for 1 year are come out of the schools. What they're saving in, you know, 460 million litres of water are saved annually from the school. Now that's every year. This is having an amazing effect on, this is really working. It also does terrifically well for the school. They save an awful lot of money on this. So this is why the teachers love it, the management love it, the kids love it, I love it. And then we went into Green Schools Travel, and that's another whole story which I really can't go into now. The minister, or John Henry, who was the National Transport Authority Director at the time, saw what was happening in Green Schools and said, we need to do this. And he persuaded the minister, and the minister then decided to give us $2 million a year to run Green Schools Travel, and that we've been running it ever since. And that is, these are the things that, the children are doing cow days, cycle on a Wednesday, wow days, walk on a Wednesday, walk every week, park and stride. The whole travel thing is enormous. And the stats are, the Department of Transport has funded us to fund schools. So now we have done sort of 5,000 cycle parking spaces, cycle training, scooter parking, all the average 40,000 students on National Wow Day. I mean, these are the stats. So, I have to move on. This is all the sort of things that they're doing. And then what happened was, the students took over. And how that happened, and this is where Charles Stanley Smith, there he is up there. Charles is chairman of the Education Committee. What was it you said?
I said today that the kids had been to primary school, secondary school, and arrived at your university to say, where is the Green Campus? Was the day that I knew it would be successful.
Yeah. Because what happened was, we had thought of doing this, but we were afraid of it. We knew it was going to be very, very difficult. A university is completely different from a school. The size of it, the disparate different, you know, people that you have in it. So we tested it, we did a little pilot, and it didn't really go well. We were afraid, but it didn't go well. And then one day we had a phone call from this girl, and she said, I am on the students' union here, and we want to get a green flag. And we said, yes. It's a bit difficult. She said, oh, you don't have to tell me that. I was the chair of my green schools committee in secondary school. Oh, really? I know how hard it is, she said. I said, oh, really? Yes. So we said, okay. And she said, if I set up a meeting down here, will you come down? And then we can sort of talk about it. And I said, okay. And of course, because it was the students' union, she got interested in the academics staff and they came, and then she got interested in management and they came, and everybody came to the meeting. And then we started talking about Green Campus. And when I tell you that there are now 22 campuses in the programme, and this is one of them. Yeah. And this is Trinity. And the man beside me has played no small part in, well, you actually had a committee before the Green Campus came in, but it gave a kind of, did help, didn't it?
Yes, gave a focus.
Gave a focus and a structure. And this is the day that Trinity, now I'm putting that one up, and it's not fair in a way, but it's because I'm here. But actually, it was UCC that did it first. And that was because she was Maria Canan, or Keran, and she is now actually a full-time post in, she's got her doctorate, hasn't she, and she's got her full-time post in UCC, but she was the one who really started it. And 2 years later, after a huge amount of work, UCC was given the first green campus flag in the world. And the template created has now spread throughout Fee, and universities within the Fee family are following Ireland's lead. I mean, that's no small achievement, because we're talking, you know, Russia, and now, you know, all of taking over. I mean, not that they wouldn't have thought of it themselves, but I mean, like any good person, if you have somebody else has created it, we don't need to reinvent the wheel. So everybody, you know, so it's really, really flourishing now elsewhere. And here's the provost, and that's me. The girls, and this is one of my favourites. I'm coming to the end, and then what do you think? We had a preschool got in touch and said, we'd like to have a flag, please. This is their committee meeting. And this fellow's my favourite, he's the chair. And he has on the move. Now listen, Kathy Baxter, who's the manager of the Green Schools program in Ireland, is here. And I said to Kathy one day, but Kathy, how many preschools have we got now?
18.
18 preschools. 18. And I said, Kathy, 18.
18.
80.
Yeah.
80 preschools. And I said to Kathy, do they actually know what they're doing? Oh, yes, she said, they're all involved in recycling and all the different bins and the colours. And if one of them puts it into the wrong bin, the others all cry. So this is the dynamic preschool committee. And to me, they are tough guys. As far as I'm concerned, this is the future. Now, I haven't talked enough about Green Campus because time has run away from me. But I mean, Ronnie could tell you the kind of things they're doing, and that's where the future is. I mean, the people in the Green Campus program in the universities are doing amazing things. I mean, we're talking about persuading the university to divest from fossil fuels. Investments in Maynooth, and Professor John Sweeney is here, welcome, and he and Maynooth are doing amazing stuff out there, and of course Trocra out in Maynooth, and we've 22, how many have we got?
27.
Deirdre, she's the manager of the Green Campus Programme, 27. And Deirdre, she sent me something about it, but honestly, I could be here for another hour reading it all out to you. All the things that they're doing. 100,000, is it 100,000 cups, disposable cups? Is that in UCC or where is it? Somebody is doing it.
Yeah, well, there's 8,000 per day going from a sample number of campuses, so it's.
They're trying, how do you mean going?
Sorry, 8,000 disposable cups.
8,000 disposable cups are produced, or I mean, are used,
exactly.
Yeah, are being thrown away every day. So this is a new campaign that the third levels are getting involved in. Anyway, it's just one thing. The one thing, as Ronnie said, was what we need is we need that the research is integrated, isn't that it, Ronnie, that you were saying? To work across the campuses, to support each other so that everybody is not doing the same thing, but that we're all doing different things and cooperating and communicating. And I mean, Dee, you had a wonderful seminar there where you had, I don't know, many universities. I was just in awe standing at the back. Anyway, that guy, I'm putting my faith in him. I got the credit. These are the people who should have the credit. Education Committee, fee founders, Clean Coast Proof Lab jury, government departments, sponsors, local authorities, teachers, students, volunteers, and staff. Wonderful, wonderful staff. And this is a quote which the new director of the Education Committee, who's sitting up there, said to me, it's amazing what you can accomplish if you don't care who gets the credit. And that's the point. People didn't look for credit. They let me have it. Thank you very much.
Someone's skimming stones across the top of a lake where it's not hitting the water all the time, and I think that talk was somewhat similar in that it only touched on little bits here and there. There are an awful lot of bits in between.
I need another few hours.
I think to save the few hours, if we turn it over now to people in the audience and see if there are any queries or questions that you want to address to Pat and focus on any particular areas. Anyone with burning questions?
I do. Pat, that was fantastic, thank you so much. And it's only when you see the whole breadth of everything that you've done over the last number of years that you really see just the huge impact that you've had. But there's one thing I think I would disagree with you on. And that is that serendipity had anything to do with it. All of those organisations there and all of those people were drawn to you and wouldn't have done the things that they did but for you. So, serendipity, don't agree.
Are you saying she's a bully?
I'm saying she's an inspiration.
Okay, Charles?
Morning. My name's Charles Hammersmith. I'm a previous chair of Antarctica, and I've been chair of education for about 2 years. What Pat said at the end of there is absolutely untrue. We wouldn't be where we are without Pat. She was very much driven by Pat. As you said, the Education Committee was there to help. We never, I don't think we ever came up with any bright ideas. I think they were all Pat's. And it's absolutely very wonderful for you to get the award tonight of a doctor and the like. But also, the other day I had another reason to realise how successful Green Schools was. There's a special school in Tipperary called St Anne's, which is now on its 7th green flag, which is more than most schools in the country. And they always invite me to come along. And the principal, the head of the place was to speak before me. And she was sister somebody, a real old-fashioned nun of the old type. She gave a 20-minute speech about green schools. I knew more about it. I knew more about the reasons why green schools were important than I did. So when it came to my time, I said, actually, I can't say anything now because Sister Patricia has just absolutely given you the whole full reason for green schools. So is that the reason I'm saying it's successful is because of her involvement, just as the school, it actually has drifted upwards into that level of green schools, green flags, as well as to the kids. And I can tell you, even though this is a special school, they got it.
Oh,
there was absolutely no thing that they didn't get. And so it is a second reason that I know we've been successful, or you have been successful.
Thank you, Charles. Thank you, everybody.
What about the fish? The woman with the fish.
Oh my goodness, the woman with the fish. Have we got another half an hour? Oh, I'll just tell you very quickly. You see, when I was thinking about this program, I was feeling, well, anyway, there was this man called Jim Reynolds, and he wanted to write a letter to the Irish Times because he was a wonderful fisherman, lived on the Boyne, and was devastated by the way the Boyne drainage had ruined the river. And he started writing a letter to the Irish Times, and then it turned into, it went on, and he said, I'll make it an article, and maybe they'll print it. And then he went on, and it turned into a book. And then he decided that he would send the book to see if a publisher would publish it, but nobody would publish it. And then his son came, I was working in publishing, as I mentioned, and his son came to me and said, my father is going to publish this himself, and we will be bankrupt because it's libelous on every page. He had no idea of the things that he was calling the people in the OPW. Every minister. And it was, you know. So anyway, he said, can you do anything? You know, because I was very friendly with his father. So I went around and I said, Jim, I hear you've written a book, and that, you know. And he said, yeah, because I know the pain. Nobody would publish it. And then I said, look, do you want me to have a look at it? Maybe I could kind of help you. So anyway, he gave it to me, and I read it. And of course, what he had done, well, there were two books in it. The first one was From the Heart. This was his rage at the destruction of the Boyne. And the second was a totally plagiarized history of Trim, Kells, and Boyne. Because you see, halfway through, when he had written all his rage, he then lost faith in himself, and he felt, this is not good enough, you know, I mean, I have to be more serious than this. So he started writing a history as well. And so he had plagiarized everybody, and in fact he'd said things like that the Duke of Wellington had been at school with Rowan Hamilton, and they had actually climbed the Yellow Steeple together. But in actual fact, I'd known that Rowan Hamilton had been a child, you know, was born 39 years later. So, I mean, it was totally incorrect. Anyway, the point is that I looked at it and said, there's one book here, but it's, you know, it's half, 600 pages he had written. And I said to him, Jim, this is a great book if we pull out all of this. Now, he had taken 2 years to do all this research, putting it all down and copying it from everybody who had written it. And he didn't understand paper, he didn't care anyway. But it was nothing to what he was calling the OPW. So I said to him, look, if I pull all of this out, we'll be left with a book. And I knew how he would feel, you know, the pain of it. So then he said, whatever you like, do whatever you like. And so I edited it, and we published it. And this is it. And it was called A Life by the Boyne. And Douglas Gageby, who was a fantastic, you know, who was a fisherman to his heart, gave it a rave review of the Irish Times. And we sold out in 3 weeks and had to republish. So the photograph there was of, Jim used to tell me about this ginormous fish that they had caught on the Boyne, and we would say yes. And of course, the thing is that it was the truth. And this was the woman who had caught this fish. Actually, I'm going the wrong way. I put all those on, I was going to show them to you, but there's no time. She had the record for the biggest fish on the Boyne, and because I wrote a note with her name and now I can't remember it. But she had a 62-pound salmon.
How many?
What?
How many pounds?
62. And it was a... Isn't that a fish? There's none of them on the vine anymore like that. In fact, I don't think there's hardly any on the vine. Anyway, that's the story. That's the poem. Oh no, I know why I wanted to tell it to you. when I was getting ready to do this lecture, I realised halfway through that I was Jim. I suddenly was telling this story and I started thinking, this is just too pathetic. It's not strong enough. I'm not a scientist, I'm not an academic. They said, what's that fine woman doing there? And so I sort of lost confidence. And then I thought, no, we'll just tell it how it was.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's extraordinary.
Thank you very much, Patricia. And I will remind everyone again the various plugs that were made. Pat earlier, anyone who is interested in Natashka, please consider joining. Anyone who is interested in Green Schools and Blue Flag and all the various programs, find out more about them and get involved in whatever way you can. And of course, within the universities, we are embarking on various different sustainability roles now, trying to, I suppose, have a green campus with a lot more academic pursuits involved. And hopefully we can integrate all of these different things because it's one common environment. We're all working towards the same thing and we should share our information and help each other. I think that's probably one of the great things that Pat has achieved during all of this. So thank you again very much.
Thank you.
Right, so Google the Irish Parliament History Network is coming on for our next lectures. And I just thank Ronnie for sharing so well. Obviously, Patricia, thank you so much. And also Paula Murphy here, College Registrar, for being key in helping to make this event happen in the first place. So thank you very much.